Hello everyone, and welcome to Cantaloupe Systems Cash Accountability webinar that focuses on how just 5 minutes a day per route can increase your bottom line. Thank you all for joining us. Before we get started, I wanted to provide some basic guidance for this webinar today. You will notice on the right side of your screen, there's a GoToMeetings questions box. Here is where you can list your questions that you have for our speakers today. We will take time at the end of the presentation to answer as many of the questions as possible. So please feel free to post at any time. Today's webinar is presented by Jason Pardue, our consulting services manager here at Cantaloupe, and Jared Detwiler, Vice President of Operations for OneSource Office Refreshment Services. Jason has been with Cantaloupe for 5 years, serving as a member of the consulting services team. Jason has been in the vending industry for 25 years, serving in various vending operation positions, starting as a route driver and ending up as a senior operations manager for North County Vending, which was a 13-branch business in California. Jason was the one to lead the implementation of Seed into NCV's operations and became the first multi-branch deployment of Seed for Cantaloupe. Welcome, Jason. Jared Detwiler, as I mentioned, is the Vice President of Operations at OneSource Office Refreshment Services, a vending, OCS, and micro-market company that is based out of Pottstown, Pennsylvania. Jared joined OneSource as a route supervisor, but after just 3 years, quickly moved into their operations manager role, where he led in early 2013 the company's technology rollout of Seed. Jared's goals are to continue to integrate all lines of business under the Seed platform so that they can increase overall route efficiency and productivity. Welcome, Jared. In today's webinar, we're going to go through an overview of the Seed platform, challenges with cash accountability that many operators face today, why cash accountability is important. Then Jason will take us through a live Seed Pro demo showing us best practices to manage our cash. We will then bring Jared into the conversation to talk about his company and the results they have had and seen with cash accounting with Seed. Lastly, Jason will recap with some of his best practices, and then we will open it up for Q&A. So first, let's talk about an overview of the Seed platform. One of the great things about Seed and what we offer at Cantaloupe is we enable operators like Jared at OneSource to manage their entire operations from one central place, Seed. However, we do make it easy with VDI capabilities to enable existing third-party hardware to connect into our back-end platform. So at the end of the day, whether you have our devices in the field or not, you can still reap the benefits of managing your operations and becoming more efficient with the Seed platform. So first we have Seed Cashless, which enables you to accept cashless payments at your vending machines. We then go into Seed Office, which allows you to really take control of your operations from the warehouse to money room to accounting practices, all housed within Seed Office. Then we offer Seed Pro, which allows operators to dynamically schedule their routes and essentially know where to go, when to go, and what to take to ensure that you're giving the best service to your customers. We also offer Seed Delivery, which allows operators to automate their OCS operations into Seed by utilizing our easy-to-use smartphone or tablet functionalities. Lastly is Seed Markets, which provides operators the ability to manage their micro-markets into the Seed platform and leverage tools like Seed Mobile to service and inventory their markets. Seed Markets is in the process of coming soon commercially to all operators while we continue to roll it out with pilot testers. But today we're going to focus on Seed Pro because that's really where you spend your time in managing cash accounts, and it's really done under this specific part of the platform. Before we dive into why it's important to pay attention to cash coming in and out of the business, we wanted to share just some common challenges that operators face today. You know, Jared initially, before they used to use Seed, they would write everything down on pencil and paper. And the ability to really track cash and account for it was very difficult. And they had multiple people within their operations doing so. So as you look at other common challenges that operators face, you know, just the common one around drivers stealing money. really, if you're not being able to account for it, it becomes really challenging to ensure that you're keeping your drivers honest. And how do you really account for that? Other challenges that operators experience are around balancing cash accounts. It can be very complex and time consuming. If you don't have the right platform or tools to allow you to balance it and check it, it can sort of become this unknown of where do you begin, and the time you spend doing so can just overwhelm you or your team. And lastly, running short on cash. You know, because we are still a cash-driven business and have been for many years heavily prior to cashless coming about, there's still a lot of cash that's going around the business and the operations. And so if you start running short on cash every day, it can add up. And cash becomes sometimes how you pay for buying more product, how you pay for your building, or, you know, depending on how much is missing, eventually how you pay your employees. So it can be a common challenge, just becomes this ripple effect. And that's why it's so important to pay attention to cash accounting within your operations. So I'm going to turn it over to Jason now to talk about why cash accountability is so important.
Cash accountability. So theft prevention, right? Proper cash accountability helps keep the honest employees honest by eliminating potential easy ways to steal and exposing those to the actual drivers so that they know they're being watched closely. Cash accountability really should be fairly simple. Doing cash accountability should not be a complex process. You should have at your fingertips some easy tools that you can look at and see what's missing from individual machines and drill into why those machines are coming up short. And it's important because peace of mind, as a cash business, our mind's always being caught up on, am I getting all my cash back? Do I have drivers stealing from me? Things that go out in the field. When you have many people touching your cash, which your business is dependent on, becomes a really important piece, and that weighs on us as operators. So we're going to step into a little bit of the Seed Pro and how to drill into some of these different pieces and some of the process that we like to recommend that operators use to drill into that cash accountability. So some of the real basic tools that I like to use is in C we have cash history. And I can drill down to, you can see I went into cash history here, and I just drilled into one day, and I'm looking at one individual route. As a process, what I like to do is review every day with my drivers where my overshorts are at. And I normally have a number that I'm looking at. I'm gonna either say, I'm gonna question anything $5 or more, or $10 or more, and you can kind of back it off and figure out what works well for you as an operator. But obviously you want to be within a good range. If you open yourself up too far, then drivers start to look at where those holes are. So for me, a good number that I like to look at is around $5 range. So there's a few things that I'm trying to do when I accomplish this. As my drivers come back at the end of today, if I review my cash history page with those drivers as they come back, so say route two comes back today, I'm gonna review yesterday's, and I'm using 818 in our test database here, but I'm going to review yesterday's cash accountability because I know now my money's been counted. It came in yesterday. It got counted either last night or it got counted this morning. My driver's coming back. Things are still somewhat fresh in his mind, and I just want to jog his memory to see if there's any errors being occurred out in the field as far as process goes with that driver. So I run this report, cash history. Again, that is through cash history, and I'm just going to drill into the one day, and I'm selecting the one driver that I'm going to talk with. So as he comes back, I'm gonna go through some of this cash accountability. And I have a couple of columns that are being exposed here. One is my DEX over short, which is ultimately my bills to box and coins to box, less any coin refill that they entered into their handheld. The other one is the meter reading. So it's taking the meter reading, non-resettable cash meter reading, and applying that against what was brought back in cash. So there's a few machines that I can look at here. And from this page, I can easily sort if I want to go, low to high to low, whichever way I want to do. And it makes it really easy for me to drill into those ones that are going to be problematic. So in this particular case here, I got one, you know, it's $66 deck short and it's 66 meter short. So from here, I can easily just open this up into a new tab. I'm leaving myself open this tab here so I can come right back to it and look at some of the other machines. Once I'm in this particular machine, now I can kind of drill into what happened on this particular service. And if I open up that visit time, it's going to give me everything that occurred. More than likely in this case, there's some missing money. So here I have my bills. The box was should have been $66. And here I can see that I only got counted back 1915 in coin, which was exactly what was in coin, right? No coin refill occurred. So he didn't use my bills to refill the coin mech. In this particular case, more than likely what happened is my driver forgot to collect the bills, right? So this could be one of two things, right? My driver could be, if I have a thief on my hands, and dealing with a thief is always a little bit more difficult. This could be not a non-honest mistake. He didn't collect the bills on purpose to see if he was going to get called on it, stash those bills in the machine. So if he did get called, he could later go back and collect that money. But in this particular case, I got no bills back. I'm not sure what happened there. Did he just forget to clear the bill stacker? Or had a technician cleared the bill stacker before and he set them on the floor, the driver forgot to grab it. But in this case, if I don't question this with my driver, then I could be creating a problem, right? If the driver has the intention of stealing that, then he's setting it up so that he could, on the next collect, he could actually keep that money. If it was a mistake, then I can easily pinpoint it and I'm letting the driver know that, hey, I know those bills aren't there. So by drilling into that and showing the driver where the mistake was and questioning it, hey, do you know what happened here? You came up $66 short in bills. I'm letting him know, hey, I'm watching this and I'm either going to send somebody back out or I'm going to send you back out to clear up this accounting problem. Okay. So really what the goal is in this process is to keep the honest people honest. A thief you're always going to be chasing after. And we can close the gaps on those as well. But in doing this process, really what I want to do is I want to pinpoint where are my problems at for this particular day's collections. And it's a real small list. There's not a whole lot there. I'm only looking at the machines that he serviced for this particular date. And I can easily drill into them and see what's going on with those particular collections. So in this case, you know, I came up a little bit short on this machine. I'm at $7 on my overshort for my decks over short and 865 against my meter. So in this case, I can see that I got 29 in bills. So we collected all of that. Nothing went to coins to box. So there was nothing expected, but I only came back with $22 and no coin refill. This might be one that maybe I ask him, did you put coin refill in? Did you forget to enter your coin refill? What occurred in this case? And really what I'm pointing out is, look, I'm watching these numbers. I'm letting you know that these numbers are not right, and I'm going to question them and I'm going to monitor them closely. And in doing that, I'm letting the driver know that, look, we're not leaving any gaps for any thievery to occur. So in this case, I'm not sure exactly what happened, but I can drill into this a little bit more. So one of the things, other pieces that I can look into is if I go back into my visits for that particular machine and I drill into the cache history for this machine. And I'm going to change this date out through the date that I wanted to go. And now I can look at my overshort just for this one machine. And I can see what my average overshort is. So here you can see I was balancing, short a dollar, not a big deal. But I had a huge overage on this other collect prior to this. So really in this case, this might be a machine that I want to flag as a machine to watch to see what occurs here. I had a big overage here. What basically occurred is I have no decks expect. So I'm not sure exactly what that number should have been. I didn't capture the decks at the time that machine was serviced on that date. And I can see that because I have no decks expect. And then I have a little bit of a shortage here. So I may want to flag this machine as a machine that I want to come back and look at. And typically what I do is I'll keep kind of a running list of those machines. And I use those from my cash accountability reporting that I might do, where I flag machines within the report itself. And then I go back and periodically check on those machines to see what's going on. But it makes it really easy for me to look at the full history of that machine, what's going on. I can see, you know, past collects prior to this one, was there an overage and now I have a shortage, where you can see those fluctuations. And a lot of times what you'll find is the coin refill is where that's at. If you got a driver that, you know, puts $20 worth of coin refill in and then he puts zero and then he puts 20 again, I'm always going to have that fluctuation of short, over, short, over, and you're going to have some fluctuation in there. That might be a good indicator where I can remind that driver, look, we want to make sure that you're filling that coin back every time you service the machine. Instead of putting $20 every other time, this machine obviously probably needs $10 every time you go, and you should be topping that coin back off. With that in mind, coin refill is really one of the gray areas where the driver has somewhat of a control. So they're entering the numbers in, they're dictating how much they're putting in when they service it. Best practice in that case is to get those drivers trained properly so that they're topping off the coin back every time they service the machine. And the reason you want to do that is when you first put that machine out into the field, it had that dollar amount in it. That coin back was full. And so if it was a $34 mech, it had $34 when it started. So if the driver goes there and it depleted down $5 and he collects that machine, but he does not refill that coin mech, then that collect will be $5 over, because the expect is to leave that $34 behind from the initial start of the machine. So watching what the drivers are doing with coin refill is really important in your cash accountability, but it's a really simple process. I can see exactly what's going on with the machine. And again, the ultimate goal is really to keep those honest people honest. So how do we deal with those guys that are going to look for the holes? You know, if I'm only questioning, say, $5, those drivers that are looking for the holes are going to pinpoint and look at, look, I know when he talks about the cash accountability on a daily basis, Jason only questions anything that's short $5. So if I only pinch $2 from every machine, then I'm never going to get called on it. Well, that's not necessarily the case. So one of the things we can also do in seed is I like to run a report, and I like to look over a longer time frame. So maybe once a month, maybe once a quarter, I want to run a report for cash accountability across an entire route or a driver. So in this case, I'm going to use the same route. I'm going to use route two again, and I'm going to show you what the detailed report looks like. It's a little extensive, but for this case scenario, I think it's a good way to look at this. So if I go into report writer, cash accountability detailed, and this report will be coming out soon in the spotlight reports. Hopefully we'll be getting rid of report writer as we build out more spotlight reports, but for right now, it's still going to exist in report writer. So I'm going to run cash accountability detailed by asset, and I'm going to run it for the month of July. And I'm going to go ahead and just filter down to the one route. And in this case, I'm going to choose route two. And I'm going to export this out to Excel. Runs a little bit quicker coming out to Excel. And I can filter and sort it real easily when I have it in Excel. So I'm going to bring this out to Excel. It's going to open up my file. And again, I'm looking at one route over the time frame of a month. And what then I'm going to be looking for is my overshorts. And I'm looking for inconsistencies or trends, right? So if I start to see things like $2 over short, $2 or $2 short, $2 short, then I'm going to have those trends in there that are going to be exposed in this particular case. So in this case, I'm not seeing a whole lot of trends going on, but again, I can go in and I can filter this down and sort it by my DEX over short or by my meter over short. And here you can see I got a huge DEX over short on this machine, might be an initial install, but I got some overages here, but I'm not seeing a whole lot of trends occurring on this particular route. So I can see lots of zeros in there, lots of balanced out machines. And again, when I'm looking at this report, what I'm looking for is those trends. So in this scenario, this one particular machine, 147187, I collected that many times in that time frame, and I can see over and over again I have a really big overage on my DEX over short. In this case, this is an offline machine, they're not capturing DEX, so that's why that's popping up like that. But what I'm looking for is those trends. So those drivers that are going to look for those holes are really going to look at what you're doing and when you're doing it. So, sorry, I ran that for 16. Let me run this for 17 and run that out again. Catch accountability detailed and July of 2017. And export that out. I apologize for that. So now we're looking at current year. And again, looking for any kinds of trends. So trends would be where you're starting to see consistency. So all of these machines, if my driver started to do things such as pinch $2 from every machine instead of $5, because I'm calling them, I'm questioning anything $5 over or short, then you would start to see a trend where you would start to see these ones that should be balancing or typically would balance would start pulling in $2 short, $2 short, $2 short, and I can really see that trend. Now I know I have somebody that's doing something that is very suspicious. In that case, I can move forward with a different process and either calling him out on this or doing some form of a setup to capture him and either prosecute or whatever it is that my company has in place for those types of scenarios. So there's kind of two pieces that I want to do. First one is let's keep the honest people honest. And really what that comes down to is if you're not questioning any cash accountability problems, the honest people ultimately come down to where, let's face it, everybody runs into some financial problems at times in their life. And I've actually had scenarios where I've sat down with drivers, either with my current customers now that I work with, that have asked me to step in and assist in some process with them, or with prior drivers that I had as an operator myself. And I've had guys that really wanted to be honest people, and their goal wasn't really to steal from us. But the problem was that when they did borrow money, nobody said anything. And when that money didn't come back, nobody said anything still. And ultimately what I did was I then took what was a person who wanted to do an honest day's work for an honest day's wage and converted him into a thief by not questioning any of those overshorts. And I've actually sat down with drivers and had them explain to me, look, I got a wife and kid at home. My electricity was going to be turned off. And I borrowed money from this machine to pay my electric bill with the intent of knowing that I was going to collect this next week and I was going to put the money back after I got paid. Well, my paycheck came and then I didn't have the extra money to put into it. So I just turned it in as it was, but nobody questioned me. And from there, it just kind of moved forward. And ultimately, I started stealing from you. And I've had those scenarios. That's a real life scenario that I've seen and I've heard from other operators as well. So doing our due diligence as an operator is to pinpoint those areas where we want to close gaps on any questions. And by bringing these accountability problems up, those overshorts up to your drivers, is really going to keep those honest people honest. That's really what the goal is. A thief, you're always going to chase after. That's the bottom line is. So if we're keeping the honest people honest, then we're going to keep those good employees, and those thieves eventually we're going to have to deal with, right? Those maybe not employees that we want to work for our company, especially being a cash business. So if we can do our due diligence, go through a quick process of a daily basis, looking at the cash history for a particular route and questioning stuff, drilling into where the problems are, maybe doing some retraining on coin refill or entering stuff into Seed Mobile, making sure that we have all the correct numbers coming back, tying that accountability out, we're going to keep those honest people honest, and we're going to keep them as good employees. And those are the ones we really want to keep. The thief, ultimately, we will have to deal with in a different way. But really, that's what our goal is. Sorry. So Jared, if you would, give us a little bit of background on OneSource.
Sure. Thanks, Jason. So OneSource Office Refreshment Services was founded in 1980 by Robert and Jackie Betts in the garage of their home, like a lot of vending companies have started. Since then, we've grown to an 18-route company employing approximately 50 people, and we're out of Pottstown, Pennsylvania. We're about 35 miles outside of Center City, Philadelphia. We service about 2,000 vending machines in 45 micro markets in the Philadelphia region. This year, we have begun to cross-train our drivers and to service all facets of our business, including vending, markets, and OCS, through the same truck, all using the Seed mobile application. And as you saw earlier, that's one of our goals as well for OneSource moving forward. We began our Seed implementation starting in 2013.
That's great. Thank you, Jared. So tell us a little bit about results.
Yep. In order for us to see results based on the challenges that we faced, we needed to start changing the processes that we had in place. They were outdated and they weren't with the times in order to be able to actually manage our machine cash accountability. It all began by installing the Seed devices on our machines. After this was completed, we were getting that DEX data back. We automated our coin room and collections by implementing the Seed coin counter interface. This allowed all the cash collections to populate automatically inside of our machine tickets, and it allowed us for accurate reporting against the DEX. This was a monster thing for us, being that we were manually using data entry to enter every one of our collections and meter readings. From this information, we were able to start gathering expected cash and coin amounts. We knew how many bills were in the box. We knew how much coin was supposed to be in the box, and it was from every machine serviced. And like Jason showed in the demo, as far as our reporting and our cash history, I use a very similar process. I break it down into three segments. I have daily things that I do, I have weekly things that I do, and then I run a report every 4 weeks. Daily, what I do is I go through each route's cash history to find any glaring mistakes that pop out to me. And I do this route by route, just like Jason showed you with route two. What I'm looking for is large shortages in collections, perhaps a bag that was missing. Maybe a driver left a bag in the safe. And from seeing those shortages of $60, $80, $100, $150, you can quickly identify that and solve a problem immediately before it comes a bigger issue. This takes about 5 minutes a day to go through all of your routes and just quickly look for your large shortages that are out there. For me, weekly, I spend about an hour or two when the weekly collections are completed going a little more in depth. I investigate the weekly cash history report looking for trends, shortages, overages, and I balance all the shortages out if they're missing coin refills. For us, we track all of what we call our mini banks, which is how much coin each driver is going out with on a daily basis. So I can tell that if he missed entering a coin refill based on the total amount of coin that he used. If bags are missing or the driver forgot to collect the bills, I actually give them a printout of the ticket that shows that they were expected to collect 120 bills and $20 in coins, and I circle that the bills were not collected, and that goes in their bin so that they are well aware that the next service, that $120 needs to come back. When the next scheduled service for the machine is collected, myself or one of the supervisors will meet with them to verify that this shortage has been fixed. I believe that more often than not, when the drivers know they're being monitored, they're much more likely to remain honest because they see that we have that real level data that's right in front of their face saying, okay, they understand that the $120 in bills I did not put in that collection bag. And then the final piece is every 4 weeks I go back over each route and take a little broader look at the cash history. And that's with the detailed cash accountability reporting. From there, I'm looking to make sure that there are no trends of $8 short on a machine level across a large amount of machines. And from there, you can drill into each visit and see, am I $2 short? Am I $2 short? Am I $2 short? And you can really start to find out, do I have a problem driver that I need to address? Or perhaps even, you know, try and create a setup method of some sorts just to see if we have a thief on our hands or if maybe there's something wrong with the DEX reporting. Overall, the results for us have been dramatic. Just from a labor point of view, not even talking the cash coming back in, we've decreased our man hours by well over 1,000%. This is a huge savings, specifically when trying to have accurate data before. We didn't even know if it was human error from data entry or whether the handwriting was illegible. These things have all changed how we look at cash accountability. After Seed implementation, some reporting tools, cash totals on a per machine basis increased dramatically. Some of this was attributed to better scheduling practices, no doubt. But what we do know is that we eliminated a lot of theft within our business based on the per machine average of cash increasing by about 5% from before and after seed implementation. Drivers are much more careful and concerned with their cash accountability now because it's visible to them. A lot of times they will come to me on a missing ticket or a miss that showed that they didn't collect the bills and say, hey, did that balance out? I wanted to make sure. It looked like there was a lot of extra bills in it this time. And by them being proactive to you, you know that they're thinking about remaining honest as well. So by keeping it out in the open, sharing shortages with them, we believe this helps keep the honest people honest. And without the Cantaloupe Systems, none of this would have been possible for us.
That's excellent, Jared. Sounds like you guys have a great process in place. And some of what you touched on, you know, being consistent is really goal number one. If you're consistently asking about cash accountability problems and trying to keep those honest people honest, you end up with good results.
The nice thing, Jason, is it's really not that difficult to do. I mean, it's a couple clicks of a tab and you run a report and you're able to see on that daily basis, hey, do I have a big problem on my hands that I got to bring up? And just those little tendencies, you know, allow you to not miss things that you would have missed previously.
Excellent. Yeah. Having the good tools in front of you definitely helps out that cash accountability process, cuts down the time, and allows you to review it on a more regular basis. Without eating up a whole lot of extra time. That's excellent. So best practices, right? You have to have some best practices in place to do cash accountability. I walk through some of what my recommendations are, some of the daily cash accountability, reviewing with the drivers, questioning things, and that's a good process. Let the drivers know what you are seeing. If you're seeing shortages, if you're questioning those shortages, then it puts in their mind that you're watching closely, that you're going to question things, and you're going to drill into it to see what's going on. And that this information that you're looking at and what they're bringing back is being accounted for. Keep an eye out for additional gaps in accounting. Dishonest employees are always going to try to find new ways to make the money that they've been subsidizing. So if they've been doing this for a while, they have a set amount typically that they want to subsidize. So another thing to look out for is for some reason, everybody forgets when Christmas is coming. So a really good press is, you know, we're coming up into that season. Christmas is coming, people want to buy gifts for their family, all that type of stuff. There's a lot of cash being handled. And we used to see on a regular basis where cash accountability tends to take a dive when we get into that season. People are looking to subsidize, making a little bit of extra money. They can easily justify it in their own head that, you know, they feel like they're underpaid, or the company, I'm bringing all this cash back, but I'm not getting a big chunk of it. So it's really easily justified in a person's own mind. So tracking those shortages month over month for those employees that might be looking for those new ways to take money. They're going to look for the holes in what you're questioning. They're going to look for the gaps, how much you're questioning. They're thinking through the whole process as you walk through with them. So having another layer of looking at your month over month or your quarter over quarter for each route or for each driver is a really good practice to have in place. That way you can find anybody that's going to be pinching $2 because you're only questioning five on the daily basis, but they're going to start to pinch two because they know they're not going to get questioned on that. So you really want to be able to track that down, look at it. Again, it's really quick. Pull up a cash accountability detail report. You have all the information that you need to pinpoint those trends and to find out what's going on. So we're going to open it up a little bit to some Q&A, and if anybody has any questions posted up, then I will go through and answer some of those questions. And again, we only have a certain amount of time, so I'll try to get to all the questions. If I can't get to them all, we'll definitely try to answer those out to each individual. And also, you can also reach out to your CSM if we don't get to your question here on today's call. So yeah, this is a good question here. We have what's better to use, meter over short or dex over short? So that's a very good question. So one of the things that I look at when I'm looking at meter or dex is a couple of pieces. I like to use them hand in hand because at times I might end up with a bad meter. You know, you get a dex spike, something happens, or the driver's not using coin refill appropriately, and so I'm going to have some variances between the two. Ultimately, there's two things that I'm always going to look at. I'm always going to look at what was expected versus what was actually brought back is what my goal is. So there's two places that you can look. One is your meter over short, one is your dex over short. So when I look at this particular machine here, this one's very clear to me, right? My bill's the box. This is where my dex over short cash countability comes from. When a customer puts a bill into the machine and it's stacked in that stacker, that becomes one bill in my bill the box. When they put coins in, there's a couple of places that coin can go. So if I put a quarter in, it can either go down to the cash box for the driver to collect, and then that would add to my coins to box, or it can go to the coin tubes and the coin mech to replenish that number. In this particular case scenario, one of the things that I look at is I'm probably going to have a meter over short problem here because of the fact that my coin mech is not being filled properly in this particular case. And the reason that I know this is you can see that I have no coins to box going, and all the coins that are going into this machine are going directly to the coin tubes, which tell me my coin tubes are short. So I'm going to have a variance between my my meter and what my expected and what my actual collect is. So in this particular case, the better case scenario is going to be my dex over short. Another thing that I can look at is this right here is what my sales is, what I sold in product as that product vended out. And typically this matches out fairly closely, if not exactly, to what my meter sales are. So I got 3065 in meter sales. This is my from last meter to this meter. This is actually my non-resettable meter reading itself. This is the difference between my previous tickets meter and this meter. So there's always a couple of different ways that I look at it. And I like to look at both really at the same time. So I wouldn't say that there's one better than the other. I use both in almost all instances. And that's one of the reasons that on my cash history page, we actually expose both, because I'm going to do some comparisons of the two as I look through it. Just because one's coming up short doesn't necessarily mean that that's the accurate number to look at. And I'm going to drill into that a little bit to see what's going on with that meter over short. But you can see this one began to balance out as it came farther into the current time. So that's a really good question. Hopefully I answered it correct.
Jason, we have a few more in the questions box. Do you want to take a look in that box as well?
I'm not seeing the questions over any more questions on that one.
Here, let me put them in the chat box for you.
Yep, excellent. Okay, good question. Yeah, how do you handle refunds that come out of the cash box? So you're going to do it the same way. Ultimately, coin refill is coin refill. It's money being you're telling the system that you left money behind. So it would work the same way as what you would be doing with a rolled coin bag. My preference would be to use a rolled coin bag, and the reason is it costs you a little bit of extra work if you're taking money from the coin box and putting that back into the coin mech versus using rolled coin. I like the trackability of using a rolled coin bag. And the reason is I know at the end of each day, I can see how much rolled coin was used and how much was entered. And those two numbers should tie out. And it's a real simple process to be able to look at what those two are if I use my driver check-in sheet at the end of the day. So if I run a driver check-in sheet, and hopefully I can find one, I can run a custom driver check-in sheet. let's see if I can find one. We have a lot of names in this test database, so you have to bear with me as I find one. I apologize. So here we go. So this is a driver check-in sheet. And so at the end of each day, I can see exactly what my driver put in for coin refill. So I would know that my total coin refill used out of my roll coin bag should match $226. So I should have $226 coming back in my roll coin bag in bills. And that should match out exactly with what they entered in for coin refill. One of the couple of problems with using the coin box, and my personal opinion, and really it is an opinion, is for one, they're trying to dig through a mix of nickel, dimes, and quarters. So the driver's used spending a lot of time on doing that. Now it will match out. Ultimately, the difference is going to be I use coins instead of bills. So I'm going to look at my variance between those two a little bit differently. As far as coin refill goes, but it's pretty straightforward, and really you're looking at the same numbers. My decks over short should match out as long as you're putting the drivers entering it into Seed Mobile or through the Seed Web application what that coin refill amount was. It will still match out on my decks over short. So in that case scenario, you shouldn't have any problems. But again, I do prefer the process of using a roll coin bag, and the machine actually buys that roll coin from that bag. It makes the process much easier to do. So how does Seed Cash Accountability handle bill recyclers? How does it account for or capture bills being paid out and or stacked in the recycler? So in majority of the cases, this is coming through the DEX file just like Rollcoin is. In using a recycler, a couple of things you got to be aware of is some of the recyclers don't give really good cash accountability. The DEX output from those is not really good. So firmware updates on those is fairly important. I'm not sure I can grab one on my particular test database to look at. But ultimately, if the driver's replenishing, then he would put that in as coin refill the same way he does coin going back in. So if he walks up to a machine and you're bringing that back up to par every time, which is the same process that you would use for coin, then you need to tell it that you're putting in how much coin or bill refill that you're putting back in that recycler. Exact same way I would do with a roll of quarters. So if I put $10 in quarters in, that'd be a $10 coin refill. If I'm putting $10 in bills, two fives back into the recycler to bring that back up to par, then I should be entering that as coin refill the exact same way. And it goes in as coin refill. We don't have a bill refill on there. I'm not even sure if we've talked about doing a bill refill. But ultimately, it works exactly the same way as a coin mech does. It's just a float that stays with the machine, and that's part of your accountability. So hopefully that answers that question. If not, definitely reach out if you have some particular bill recyclers that you might have some problems with in looking at that cash accountability on. Definitely reach out to your CSM, and we can help you through that process. In some cases, it might be something as simple as a firmware upgrade that needs to be done on the recycler, because some of them don't have, some of the older versions of that firmware don't have really good output for DEX. And then how do we track offline machines that don't have a working cash counter? So that gets a little bit more difficult, and really the only process, if you don't have a cash counter, you're going to have to look at what your product sales was versus collected amount. It's pretty rare to in today's market to not see a cash counter, or at least a VINS counter out there that you can actually do some calculations against. So that's a kind of a unique scenario, but ultimately what you can do is you can look at what the total sales were in product because we're tracking that based on the bins. And this is particularly for offline machines that you're going to find this, obviously. But I would look at what my total product sales was against what my cash collected was. Is probably the best process for that. And then I'm going to take one more. We're running a little bit over time here. And it's asking me to explain a little bit more about what buying roll coin from a bag means. So best process for roll coin is each driver goes out with a bag of rolled coin. We called it a roll coin bag, and each driver has their bag, and it's a certain amount of mixed coin. Dollar rolls of dollar coin if you got dollar coins out on the route, quarters, nickels, and dimes. And ultimately, you're walking out, you have that roll coin bag, and if a machine needs roll coin, say I walk up to a machine and it needs $5 worth of quarters. Ultimately, what I would do is I would take 10 $1 bills from the bill stacker of that machine. I would put those 10 bills into my roll coin bag. I would take out the $10 roll of quarters. I would fill $5, because that's all the machine needs, in my quarter tubes. And then the rest of that roll coin from that quarter roll, the other $5, would then go in my collect bag for that collect for that day. Now, the ultimate process in that is to leave the machine with the exact amount that coin mech holds. And the reason is when I take a machine from my shop, I prep a machine, I put it out in the field. If I have a $34 mech in that particular machine, then I'm putting that machine out in the field starting with $34. So $34 is the actual base start point that machine should always be left with. And my process of using a roll coin bag actually allows me to help better track what the driver is using and what the driver is entering as coin refill. And the reason I like to do that is when I start looking at my cash accountability, I can track whether my driver is doing a good job of entering in what they're putting in for coin refill, which helps out my cash accountability process and makes it a lot cleaner to look at on a screen. So if a driver is failing to do part of this process, I can easily drill into that and see what's going on and correct that process and get the driver to do the proper things. Hopefully that answers that question. And I just got a note from our product management team. So bill recycle or refill is coming soon to Seed. So that should be coming out soon. So that kind of answers going back to the previous question. And just to let everybody know, we're running out of time here. We're actually over time. I don't want to hold up anybody longer than what we expected. But just remember a reminder that the video presentation should be out in the next 48 hours to all the attendees. We'll provide an online link and access to that. So you'll be able to review this, go back through it. And then if you have questions, definitely reach out to your CSM, Cantaloupe CSM, if you have those questions, and drill into this. Really the goal again today is talk a little bit about this process, and walk through, some of that process and what good process looks like. We're able to hear from Jared and some of the process that he used. We walk through a little bit of the process that I normally recommend for operators. But it's about keeping the honest people honest. If we can keep our honest employees honest, then we've done our job. A thief we're always going to have to track down. Let's be honest. This is a cash business, and we are going to run with those thieves at times. We are going to have those problems with those individuals, and we're just going to need to be able to deal with those. But we do have a good process in place looking at that, try to track those individuals down that are going to be those problematic ones. But I've also seen guys that were thieves, and we've been able to turn them around. Just by doing the simple process of pinpointing the fact that we're watching and monitoring what's going on, we're monitoring the cash, what's expected and what you're bringing back, and questioning those problematic machines and where we have shortages coming back. So I thank everybody for coming out to this webinar today. Definitely feel free to reach out to me if I'm your CSM, or reach out to your CSM. And again, we'll be sending out a link to this video, and we'll make it available, and it should be out within the next 48 hours.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Have a great day.